He rises for Pledge of Allegiance.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Thank you and welcome to the Board of Selectmen's meeting for June 27th. Our first thing is a public hearing to terminate a 50-year conservation easement on map 67, lot 1.
Mr. Chairman, this is a public hearing notice 2 weeks ago pursuant to RSA 547:3-d. This is the statute that deals with the doctrine of cy pre, by which the probate court in New Hampshire with the New Hampshire Charitable Trust Division of the Attorney General's Office can modify a trust. A conservation easement is deemed to be a trust under New Hampshire law, and in this case, the Cornerstone Development has involved within it a parcel of land, approximately 2 acres in size, which includes a conservation easement. Unusual in that it was a 50-year duration with now 6 years remaining. And so the developer and the seller have been working with the Conservation Commission and have reached an agreement regarding, in principle, regarding how the remaining 6 years are to be terminated. And I will let Barbara Renaud, of the chair of the Conservation Commission, describe that. And then I would like to have Attorney Ovid Lamontagne, who prepared a very well thought out resolution for this board, to describe that to you. And along the way, we can discuss a couple of issues that had arisen at the last meeting of the board. So, Barbara, can you describe that? I've passed out a couple of items. The first is the June 8, 2016 letter that you had at your last meeting. Barbara?
Okay. One of the requirements of the Attorney General's is that they have a letter of support for the release of this easement from the Conservation Commission. So we are here to request your approval of that letter of support from us to the Attorney General in order to effect the early release of the conservation easement on the parcel of land at 298 Exeter Road. As Mark said, this is a 50-year easement that was placed on the property in 1972 and has 6 years remaining on it, and it will terminate after 6 years. And again, as Mark said, the easement encumbers about 2 acres of a larger parcel of land. As compensation for the release of that easement, the Conservation Commission has discussed this at length with the current owners, and we have agreed to the following. First is a transfer of 2 acres of a parcel on Timber Swamp Road to the town. So that would become owned by the town as conservation land. In addition, the owners will give us a perpetual conservation easement on an additional 2 acres of land on Exeter Road, fronting on Exeter Road. Along with that easement in that parcel, they will also grant us access to the Old River. The Old River comes down through the larger parcel, and they will grant us access to that river so that we can go in and control invasive species and keep the river water healthy and clean. And that water is also flowing down into other land. It's very, very on its way to the Taylor River, and it's very important that that water be kept as pristine as possible. This will be highly beneficial to the town. Number one, it's twice as much land. Number two, it has a higher conservation value in terms of wildlife habitat, flood control, and just protection of our rivers and streams. And Jay can tell you a little bit more about that and point out the parcels that we're referring to there. Rhianne, put them in black.
This is where the easement is that's being terminated. This is a 2-acre easement within the parcel that's looking to be developed. This lot here is a total of 6 acres. Four of those acres are being offered as mitigation for another parcel. 2 acres there are being deeded to the town as compensation for our support in releasing this easement. And this parcel up here is the one that's going to be put under a conservation easement in perpetuity. And the old river that Barbara referenced flows down through here, through a culvert under Exeter Road into the Carbarn Pond, down into the Batch Elder Farm, through the Hurd Farm area, into the Taylor River. So it's part of a pretty significant watershed. And as Barbara pointed out, the parcels that we're gaining include wetlands, buffers, and uplands, so it's very valuable to the town. I just want to point out, if I may, briefly, a couple of things. I've never seen a limited time conservation easement before. Every other conservation easement that exists in Hampton that I'm aware of is in perpetuity. And it's only because this is a limited time conservation easement that the commission agreed to even discuss the possibility of terminating this easement. We take our easements very seriously, as you all know, and we appreciate the fact that you, the selectmen, and the townspeople have supported our efforts to protect land in Hampton. And it's because this is a temporary easement, there are only 6 years left on it, and because, as Barbara pointed out, what the town is getting in exchange for our support for terminating this easement is much greater than what we're giving up. Because of those two factors, we're willing to support this effort. Other than that, I think we would be more inclined to let an easement stand because those easements are negotiated in good faith and for good reason. But here again, I think the long-term benefit is the town. And so it's for that reason that the Conservation Commission is supporting this effort to amend this easement.
Well, good evening. My name is Ovid Lamontang, and I represent the current owners of the land that's encumbered by the conservation easement, the limited purpose conservation easement, in that it's 50 years. Incidentally, the conservation easement was granted in 1972 before New Hampshire statute was ever enacted to recognize a conservation easement. So it is peculiar in that it's limited to 50 years. The principals who own the particular, or hold title to this particular land, also own title through other entities of this other land that's being used as a conservation easement exchange for purposes of satisfying state law and the requirements of the town. I would want to add for the record that as part of our submittal to the state of New Hampshire, we're required as well to show the comparative values of these parcels. And so town council has received a copy of the full appraisals, which were performed by Bergeron Commercial Appraisal, showing that the conservation easement value currently is about $43,000. But just the one lot that's being conveyed to the town conservation commission in fee simple interest, subject to a conservation restriction of 6.6 acres, is worth, as a conservation parcel, $143,000. Now, that's not the only characteristic or requirement that the state will look at in terms of relative economic value, but it's certainly an important factor that they look at. And I would hope that you'd be even more comfortable with this decision and this action tonight, knowing that. Again, town council has the full appraisal reports. I'm grateful to Mark Gerald for also distributing what is before you, which is a resolution which I would recommend be incorporated in this final submittal to the state as well as to the probate court. What it is essentially a recital of the facts, and also beginning on page two, are recitals regarding what's called the seven principles that the state of New Hampshire Director of Charitable Trusts Office looks to in either amending or terminating a conservation easement. Things such as whether or not anyone has a pecuniary interest that is somehow being taken advantage of. I'm saying we don't. No one does, as far as I know, and as far as Attorney Gerald knows.
Do you have an extra copy?
I do have several copies.
Okay, Attorney, just
skip to page two.
We don't have page two in here.
Okay.
Thank goodness for humidity and copiers.
That's better. Thank you.
Okay, thank you.
And so the recitals, again, track the seven principles. They lay out the facts about why it is that you're hopefully going to decide to act, move in this direction, and that is, again, to move to terminate the conservation easement and to accept other property in exchange for the easement. And then the resolutions, as you will see, essentially approves the Conservation Commission's recommendations, authorizes town council and town manager to pursue whatever actions are necessary to, in fact, perfect the termination of the conservation easement, as well as to accept property in exchange for the termination of the conservation easement. And it should constitute a fairly complete record for purposes of this part of the transaction. I want to commend and thank, on behalf of my clients as well as the buyer's representatives of the town, the professional staff, as well as elected officials, for their willingness to work through this issue, which only came to light, as they all do usually. These issues come to light at the tail end of a project which has been under development, or at least under development for over a year now.
Okay. Go to the public first.
Sure, I'd open up for public comment.
Yeah, I'll open up for public comment. Is there anybody from the public that would like to speak?
Good evening, Mr. Chairman, members of the board. I'm Nathan Page, 200 Drakeside Road, and also a member of the Conservation Commission, for full disclosure. I spoke with one of the heirs of this, who granted the 50-year easement, Peter Randall. And we spoke for quite a bit. He spoke with his co-heirs, and for lack of a better term, and they were all but one, which they could not get a hold of, were 100% in favor of granting this release of this and passing it along to the allowing the town to gain 4 acres for the price of two, for a simplification. And they were very happy that they're going to be sending a letter to the court as well to assist in this easement being released. And also, I'm in favor of it, as Costa.
Thank you. Anybody else from the public?
Nancy Stiles, Mount Hayden Circle. I'd just like to thank the board for working through this process and all you can do to support business growth in this community.
Thank you. Anybody else from the public? Seeing none, I'll bring it back to the board. Would you like to?
No, I think the process has resulted in this resolution. We would recommend the board, if you so choose, to support the resolution and move forward.
All right. Regine, any questions?
I think, like I stated before, I think it's a great, we're getting twice as much land that will be conserved. It looks like the value of it is better than the land we currently have, so I think it's a good idea.
I think it's a win-win, no problem.
Cool.
Yeah, it's an extraordinary project by extraordinary owners, and the conservation agreement to relieve this temporal encumbrance is just a superlative job. So, Madam Chair, your commission has done an outstanding job and has performed at a very high level. Those are two extraordinary properties that are being exchanged outside of the monetary value. It's just environmentally, they're much more extraordinary acquisitions for the town and or for easement. So fully support the resolution. We've all done our homework on the source documents to include review of the initial easements and want to make sure that we do everything continuing this evening to make sure that this is a fast track for further movement forward. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Mr. Griffin.
Yes. I'd like to, you know, say that I think it's a really good, clean solution that everybody's happy. And congratulations, Barbara, for your first big project. Thank you for all that you all do.
So,
need a motion to
accept the resolution.
I'll make that motion.
Motion to accept the resolution by Rick, seconded by Jim. All those in favor? Unanimous.
Thank you very much.
All right.
Thank you.
All right.
appreciate it.
Including a side trade potential. Why don't you stay? That's the only way to
meet. Show me this thing. Why do you need
to come? Why don't you stay? Thank
you very much. It's really a pleasure.
Why don't we do it now?
I'm sure we'll see you.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
Mark. Thanks.
Mark.
Thanks for doing it.
Mark, stay there.
Yeah.
Now we'll deal with this.
Okay, we're going to go slightly out of line right now because we do have the Conservation Commission here. And so we're going to take one thing previous to getting into our regular calendar. And that's the approval of the acceptance of forested land map 59, lot 1, to the Conservation Commission for 1.9 acres.
We are asking that you approve and accept this donated parcel of land. It's known as map 59, lot 1. It's undeveloped land in the town forest. The total parcel is 1.9 acres, but 0.9 acres is in Hampton and 1 acre is in Northampton. And the owner would like us to take ownership of the entire parcel. Again, it is land right on the border of Northampton, overlaps, and right in the center of our town forest area. The owner has been very gracious about being willing to donate this land, so we do ask that you approve and accept this donation.
Questions from the board?
Nothing.
I'll make that motion.
No questions, and
the only question I had is that there's no legality in the Hampton Conservation Commission owning property in Northampton.
There would not be, and they would not be taxed.
Very good. That's good. So
I'll make
Rick
that motion.
Made the motion, seconded by Phil. All those in favor? Unanimous. Okay.
Thank you. Very much.
All right.
Thank you. Thank you very
now
much.
Now we'll get to the public comment period. Is anybody in the public that would like to speak?
Yes, thank you.
My name is Tom Doyle, 3 Dumas Ave. Great Boar's Head, and I'd like to pass something out to each of the selectmen. I don't want to take much time here, because I realize
it's time. Thank you.
The issue we're facing at Great Boar's Head is we appear to have a significant violation of the Residence A zoning ordinance. There's a residence at 12 Cliff Avenue, Great Boar's Head, Hampton. In that little packet I sent you, I show pictures of the congestion. There's also there's a couple of construction trailers, one of which has a power line running out to it. And where this property is, if you go up Dumas Ave, you take a right on Cliff, it's the 4th house on the right. And I show it in the tax map there. The zoning board in 2006 denied a variance to add a third unit here. And they denied it. However, it appears to have been done anyway. And I also put in the assessor's card, which shows this building is a two-family with an unfinished basement. So it seems as though there's some, kind of flaws in the process when something gets denied, gets done anyway. Also, there are some 12 cars parked in front of this building. As I said, 2 trailers, one of which has a power line going to it. I think it's a sad scene in Residence A on Great Boar's Head. And a lot of the owners are here tonight to show their concern. But also, as you know, the people on Great Boar's Head, Place Cove, North Beach, with a lot of oceanfront property, pay some very high property taxes. And we feel this is a diminution in the value, but also it's kind of an eyesore in the neighborhood. So we're asking for the Board of Selectmen to assist us by enforcing the Hampton zoning ordinances to have less intensive parking there. That certainly is not a 22-foot driveway. It covers about the whole 73 or 75 feet in front of the house. And also removal of the construction trailers, which shouldn't be there anyway. And that's what we want to say. And I thank you for your attention.
Thank you. Anybody else that would like to get up and speak?
Good evening. Mary Louise Woolsey, 148 Little River Road. For those of you on the board and also for the viewing public, August 10, 2015 and September 28, 2015 live streaming videos, you will get the context of what I'm going to discuss here by means of a what I consider a serious violation of the perambulation of the town lines with Seabrook. RSA 51:2, perambulation of town lines. The lines between the towns in this state shall be perambulated and the marks and bounds renewed once in every 7 years forever by the select men of the towns or by such persons as they shall in writing appoint for that purpose. You will see in those two meetings a discussion with the town manager and setting up a perambulation with the town of Seabrook after the seafood festival, etc. I didn't realize until I got the 2015 annual report, page 19 is a printout of the perambulation report, and I was never notified by anyone, not by the manager, not by the chairman, not by anyone on the board. And every time the manager brought up the topic of perambulation, I raised my hand to volunteer. It is the job of selectmen. I would like to know, I'm seeing signatures from two Seabrook selectmen, that's two-thirds of their board, signature of the Seabrook manager, and a signature of Frederick Welch. Not one selectman in sight, and Frederick Welch is a resident of Seabrook. How dare you allow a perambulation like that to happen, A, without letting me as one member of the board know, and I would like to know who signed the writing, the written document appointing Frederick Welch for that purpose. And I don't think it's funny, Mr. Bean. I don't think it's funny at all.
Mr. Chairman,
I
objection.
I talked to Brian Burford.
Mr. Chairman, objection.
Keep interrupting me.
I am objecting to this behavior.
I talked to Brian Burford up at the Records and Archives in Concord and asked him what you do if you feel a perambulation has been illegal. And he said you'd have to take it to Superior Court. I think it's a shame to have something improper and illegal recorded in the archives of the state of New Hampshire in behalf of the town of Hampton because everyone is either too lazy or too incompetent to do a proper perambulation. And speaking of lack of communication, which happened constantly on the prior board, I only learned in February of this year of a very serious criminal case that happened in May of 2013 in this town.
Mr. Chairman.
And the town
manager never
called that board together. So I think we need
three
to do
minutes.
Yes, I know. We need to do a better job here cooperating, I think.
Thank you. Anybody else in the public that would like to get up and speak?
Walter Kivlin, 10 Fellows Avenue. Members of the board, thank you very much for your time. The illegal parking lot at 18 P Street continues in operation, and they have been given a cease and desist by the town manager, and we're going to have a tragedy there in that crosswalk. If this continues, it's unsafe for our whole neighborhood. And I feel terrible for these poor people that are talking about 12 cars being parked. We're having cars being parked like that. Unreported income. I mean, there's so many failures to the law, it's ridiculous. And the other thing is on the agenda, appointments, number 5, Toby Reynolds and Trish Morrissey from the DOT,
mm-hmm.
looking for A, the right of entry request for Drakes River, Taylor River, and US-1, New Hampshire 101 interchange resurfacing. Finally, the state is here asking us for something. So I think it's finally that we ask the state for everything and we don't get any response or we get a response of zero. The state is in violation of the American with Disabilities Act because they do not have a crosswalk at the state, North State, South Beach State Park to allow handicap accessible people access to Uta's restaurant, Gorin's fishing, and the beauty of the state pier. They're in non-compliance of ADA. I would ask that we ask them to comply. Thank you very much for your time.
Thank you, Walter.
Mr. Chairman?
Yes.
I think that the people that are here with Mr. Doyle, I think they've all didn't bother to come up and talk individually, and I wonder if Mr. Sullivan can respond to them a little bit. He's looked into this.
Well, let's make sure we can make everybody has public comment first. And if any of those people that did come with Mr. Doyle, if they'd like to get up and speak, by all means do. Come up, please. Please just state your name so that we can have that on record.
Phyllis Skidley, Boys Head. One question is, when will we know when this is decided upon about this tenant problem on Boys Head? How long will that take?
I can't give you an exact, but the process to deal with that is through our building department and planning department. So mm-hmm. it's certainly going to take, you know, probably at least a week to get the complaint to him. And I'll get a better idea after we go through those issues to see where we're at.
Okay, great. And did you notice on these papers that there is a basement apartment in this house that should not be there?
Yeah, we have the writing with all of the issues, which is what building needs in order to proceed.
Okay. Right. Because we all pay such high taxes. We want it nice. Thank you.
Not a problem. Is there anybody else that would like to get up and speak at public comment? A lot of people here. Okay, I'll bring it back to the board then. Announcements and community calendar. Regina.
I don't have anything.
Jim? Nothing, but it's beautiful summer weather. Beaches seems to be going really nice, and people should be careful in driving around town.
Mr. Bean.
Yes, some people, as Jim has just so aptly stated, and we just heard a diatribe about it, a person that sued everybody on this board that had public comment and further insults the board and the town and the great quality of it. It's summertime. It's an extraordinary time in Hampton. These folks are extraordinary business owners. Our operational tempo is at full force. I'll raise my voice so you can hear over folks leaving. And it just really is a remarkable town. And some of these people, like Miss Woolsey, that come in pale-skinned, and you never see them on the street, you never see them on the beach, but they know everything. And they're demagogues, and it's a very low bar for a public servant to come in here, and a former selectman who was quoted in the newspaper a couple of weeks ago saying that she wanted nothing to do with the town anymore, who sued us and was asking for attorney's fees, this last board, who prior to not being elected as the chairperson stated that it was the best board she had ever worked with under Mr. Griffin's chairmanship. And that is a new low, her performance tonight. And I would be an advocate that we gavel earlier people that act so ill-mannered and unfitting with what goes on in Hampton. It was a beautiful summer weekend. It is a fabulous community. People take fabulous care in this town. It's a proud community. The Hampton Chamber of Commerce, which is proudly serving the New Hampshire seacoast in Hampton, asked that this be read tonight. Dave Hartnett has asked to send this notice out to our membership. That would be the Hampton Chamber of Commerce, that they are regarding a cookout that Dave is hosting for the new hires of the Hampton Police and Hampton Fire Departments, as the Chamber will be participating to help. Wednesday, June 29th, from 4 to 6 p.m. at the Mainsail, which is David's Hotel. They'll be hosting a cookout for the police and fire, as I said, and the purpose is to welcome those hardworking men and women that are recent hires and introduce them into the community so we get to know who's serving us so diligently and thank them for their service to the businesses and the communities and the citizens of this town. So Dave and the Chamber wanted this invitation to be extended all to the members, and again, that is on June 29th. And that's from 4 to 6 p.m. That's a Wednesday night. Dave Hartnett's telephone number is 603-765-8037. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you. Mr. Griffin.
I would just like to say also, to echo on what Mr. Bean said, Mrs. Woolsey is the one that volunteered to be part of that preambulation. And I myself couldn't do it because it was during the day. She volunteered to do it. Why she didn't go, I don't know. But I think it's another low point here at the Board of Selectmen that someone that's been voted out of office doesn't realize there's a new captain of the ship and it's sailing in a different direction. Thank you.
Well, and I'll kind of chime in a little bit on that is I did go back and look at it, and the town manager did notify us afterwards that he had done it at the, I believe it was the next meeting. And if you look back in the history, 2008, the same people signed it. Those were the same people that did that. And when we were notified that it was done, Mrs. Woolsey was on this board at that time. She was also on this board when we got the town report, and it came out before she got off this board. And I'm sorry if she feels that she was slighted, but it is what it is. So, okay. Consent agenda. First one is road closure, St. Cia Drive on July 3rd. Entertainment licenses for the Ashworth by the Sea. A liquor license for the Ashworth by the Sea. Dance hall permit for the Ashworth by the Sea. All three of those are due to ownership changes. License for coin operated devices. There's a couple of them. Pool table permit. The War Memorial Committee appointments. G. Buckley Bennett, William Sullivan, Michael Edgar, and Chris Nevins. Recreation Advisory Council appointment, Tim Hanlon. Hampton Area Chamber of Commerce, use of town property for seafood festival, satellite parking. That's the consent agenda. Do I have a motion to?
So moved.
Just a second.
I'll second it.
All those in favor? Unanimous. The next one is our appointments, and the first appointment up is our treasurer, Ellen Lavin.
Good evening.
Good evening. Good evening.
I was here the 1st of June, and you actually voted for me to go out and borrow $4 million, which I have, well, I haven't borrowed it. I've gone through bond counsel. They've reviewed everything. I have tonight a certificate saying that you had a meeting, you approved that I was allowed to go out and borrow. That I have two of those which need to be signed. I also have a tax anticipation note line of credit rider, which tells me or all of us how I can borrow. If I wanted $500,000 or $200,000, I do not have to borrow all of it at one time. I have two of those that need to be signed, and then I have the actual note that needs to be signed.
Okay.
So if I could pass those around.
Pass it around, we'll get it signed, and you can get out of here.
Do I
need a vote to sign these?
Probably to be safe.
Yeah. Okay, I need a motion to accept these and sign them.
Make a motion.
I'll second it.
All's in favor? Unanimous.
And I know it's been stated before what this is for, but just so that anybody's watching tonight, we're not borrowing $4 million.
Right.
It's for tax.
Tax anticipation.
Right.
So at some point, the taxes are all due on Friday. So far, I have enough money in the bank today, so I will not be borrowing between now. And it may happen in November. It may happen in October. This note actually expires at the end of the year. So by December 31st, if I borrow $4 million, I have to pay all that.
So people
borrow as we need. Actually, last year we did not borrow anything at all. So,
thank you.
You're welcome.
That's the note.
No, just the beach.
How is it, beach?
It's great.
Yeah, it is.
Tomorrow is I actually have to have the town clerk put her seal on these and her signature. The note will be delivered to Provident Bank, and then the rest of the paperwork goes back to Divine and Element, where bond counsel approves that everything was done properly. So actually the note is not effective until June 30th. I got two sets. One's going one way.
Keeping that one close.
That still needs some signatures.
I have four off the
bar. I think Jim needs that one back.
Let's double check. I don't know if I...
Did I sign
that
one?
No.
Are you on here?
Yep, I'm on the top.
The second line is Jim.
Second line would be Jim. Jim needs that.
I think he needs this one.
Hard work, Ellen.
Thank you.
Next appointment is Christine Pullman, monthly financials.
Hello. All right, I am here with financials for the month of May. You should have received them in your box a couple weeks back now, I think. June 10th, it looks like. It's the fifth report for 2016. And the target is 41.67%. The month's total income was $698,848. Of that total, motor vehicles came in at $337,079, which is over the adjusted month's target by $89,079. The other major contributors to the month's total were payment in lieu of taxes of $120,000. That's the NextEra settlement. Interest on taxes at $107,395, building permits at $23,434, departmental income at $39,909, parking lots at $24,880, and the real estate trust at $37,396. I added a new bullet there. I kind of gave you a comparison of revenue comparison for May of 2015 compared to May of 2016. The total revenue is down by $100,743. The main factor here is that in 2015 we received health insurance reimbursement, which we will not be receiving this year. And then I went on further. The financials are on the website, but I did go on further and kind of compare some different line items that were over and under, just for something new for your reading. The expense summary shows that the year-to-date expenses by department at the end of May, the operating departments without debt service but with open POs were 38.61% of the budget, which is under the month's target by 3.06% or $738,441. I point out there that we're headed into our busy season, so to be that far ahead doesn't necessarily predict anything for the future, because we're just starting to pick up with summer, with the summer season. And then I also added a new bullet here showing you that in May of 2015 we were at 40.1% compared to the 38.61% in 2016, and gave you a breakdown of some further expense lines there. On overall, the departments as a whole are running under the target of 41.67%. The planning board contracted services and dues is at 72.9%, and the department is now over target as a whole at 45.25%. The police department is at 35.13% overall with the open purchase orders included. Accounts to note here are under administration, the computer supplies and expenses, traffic control and patrol sick leave wages. Training as a whole section is over target at 64.79%. Support services, OT training wages and vacation wages. And under police stations and building, the OT wages are over slightly. And the fire department is at 40.91% overall with the open purchase orders included. And one account that I noted there was under administration at the whole section of administration is over target at 43.8%. In highways and streets is at 34.32% overall with the open purchase orders. And in municipal sanitation is running slightly under target at 41.45%. If you do not include the annual PO for chemicals, the department is at 38.94%. Some accounts to note in this section are under the transfer station. There's no new accounts that are over target, but the section as a whole is over target at 45.89%. And sewage collection and disposal as a whole is over target at 74.98%. Culture and recreation is at 36.28%. And the account that I noted there was under administration, the OT wages. The library as a whole is over target at 42.63%. Patriotic purposes is over target at 114.73, but we buy all of our flags for Memorial Day, so we won't be spending from that line anymore this year. Warrant articles passed at the town meeting. Health agencies have almost all been paid, and we're just seeing increased activity in all of those warrant article projects. Let's see, the 2015 encumbrances are showing that 60% have been expended to date. Recreation fund balance is at $184,789. The beach sticker donations year to date equal $6,620, and $15,494 have been granted in scholarships. The cable committee fund balance is at $104,226. There's a large jump there as a result of the vote that now 100% of the franchise fees go to the cable fund, and we received our second payment, so that whole payment of $81,000 went into fund 25. The private detail fund, the current balance is $120,007, and the EMS balance is at $321,477. There's, I think it was up over $400 last month, and the ambulance has been purchased from that account, so that's why that has dropped so much. The wastewater system development charge fees collected in 2016 total $30,066. I think we took in another $10,000 just last week, so that number has already increased. The balance in the account is $206,594. However, we do have expenditures that have been approved, but not yet expended from that fund by the board. So that is what I had.
Very good. Any questions of the board? Regina.
Christy, very important. Thank you very much for the update. Some people have voiced some concerns to me as far as, I know this has already been established at prior meetings, that the $37,360 that shows up under 2015 encumbrances on page 8.
Yep.
I talked to you about it. As to why that amount is still shown there, even though at the end of 15, it was still out to bid. And so, you know, actually, we ended up agreeing to the bid in 2016, and the money is going to come out of the 2016 budget.
Budget, yes.
But I think what people's concern is the $37,000 that is still showing there. And I just thought maybe if you could explain that for the public.
Yeah, well, the purchase order that ended up being liquidated was for $27,000. There was additional purchase orders from that line item. I printed out the purchase order report for radio systems for two different vendors, totaling about almost $9,000, and then a $1,000 purchase order for brand company. I don't know exactly what they were buying, but so that $37,000, a portion of it still is actually active in purchase orders. The other $27,000 has been liquidated. It no longer appears on the purchase order reports that we have and is not available for spending. It is on this report, and it is my understanding, I have put in a question to the auditors too, just to see if it should be removed, but it's my opinion that this report is showing all of the encumbrances that were outstanding as of 12/31/2015, and it was a vote by the board to encumber all of those funds and bring them forward into 2016. It was in 2016 that it was deemed that purchase order should not have been issued because there was not a secure contract in place, and therefore the purchase order was liquidated and the funds were exhausted from that purchase order. And at the end of this year, when all of the monies that weren't expended from those 2015 encumbrances, because there will be other ones that, you know, there could be another line item that they had a purchase order for $7,800, but they only spent $7,000. All of that money at the end of the year when we do the 2016 audit will be put back into the unassigned fund balance at that time. If it is okay with auditors to remove it from this report, then I would be happy to do that once I speak with them. But for right now, the auditors look at this report, they use this report, they see what was encumbered, what wasn't encumbered. If you look on page number 15, I believe it is, the if you add up the purchase orders that have been exhausted, you would find that that $27,000 is no longer in there because it has been liquidated. You know, it's not available. So that's the best explanation that I can give.
Thank you very much.
Yeah.
Good. Just a couple of things, Christy. Good report. Overall, we're in good shape.
Yep.
Everything's on target, right?
I think feels okay. Like it is, yes.
Good. And we're still going up on the motor vehicles. We're going up on building permits and stuff, but we have to be aware of the fact that if the economy were to turn around drastically, that could go the other way too, right?
Yes.
So it's not something that's just going to go on forever and ever, which is important. The ones that have that are down... I'm looking here for, like, franchise fees under by $53,000. Are you looking at those that are down and not up and why they're down?
I was just trying to give you guys a comparison because it had been asked of me to compare where we were at, like, a certain time yeah. last year as to this year and differences that I saw. So what I did is I pulled out the financials from May of 2015 and kind of went through and looked line by line or section by section which sections. And so the franchise fees is down by $53,000, but I explained that a minute ago because all the franchise fees are now going
so
to fund
fast,
25.
I'm sorry.
They're all going to fund 25 now. So that, and so I just was kind of pointing out things that were up and things that yeah. were down and reasons that I knew of off the top of my head the why a certain line was down and a certain line might be up.
Right. And there are certain departments that the overtime or hired equipment in the summer for the transfer station
mm-hmm.
was 138%, and one was, or 500% it was. Now, is that because of budgeting miscalculations, do you think, or?
I think on that particular line item, it's such a small line item. It's a departmental, I've talked to Public Works, to Chris Jacobs, and kind of pointed out to him that this section as a whole is over, and we discussed some of the line items. That's one of those ones that when you're looking at it's like a $500 line item, I think.
Yeah.
Or 200 or something like, yeah, it's 200 and they've spent 12, you know. And I think what they use that line for, from is my understanding, is to transport things if they need to be repaired. And so you can't really predict exactly
right.
what, but
right.
it's not that big of an overage because you're looking at a $200 line item. The OT wages is a little bit high, and he explained that as a personnel issue. They had a part-timer that would work there, and now they're having to fill those shifts with overtime and stuff. So,
okay.
But he is aware of it. He was made aware of it, and he understands that section is over as a whole.
Okay. And in fire suppression, two overtime wages were at 93.
And the fire chief... would probably, I haven't spoken to him, but my best guess is he would express that as in regards to all of the injury leave that he has had, personnel again.
Right.
Because
so
he has to have his staffing levels at certain levels.
Yeah. It's all something that people are aware of and paying
yes.
attention to
yeah.
and that we're aware of. Okay, thank
yep.
you very
what
much.
What I do is when I send the financials, I used to just send them the Excel spreadsheet part, but I've been sending them the narratives so they know each department is made aware of the different things that I see as issues and that I'm pointing out to you, so when they receive that, they can, you know, see. see exactly where I feel that they might want to be watching.
Thank you.
Phil.
Yes, Mr. Chairman, thank you. Director, good evening. Great brief. How long have you been the director now?
It was 2 years in May.
You've done one heck of a job, and your department does a heck of a job. You brief us on the revenue or the income statement monthly or quarterly. And importantly, is the financial position of this town is in incredibly good shape, incredibly well run, with fund balances. Our net position is sevenfold what the New Hampshire State Liquor Commission does, and that's a $700 million enterprise. And of course, we're much smaller than that. Having said that, you are the director of finance, one of the largest corporations in the Seacoast, and you've done a magnificent job, and we appreciate you very much.
Thank you.
Welcome.
He said it all.
Thank you.
Thank you.
The only one thing I had is just like you said on the fund, the EMS fund, that did drop, but they did purchase a new ambulance, and that is now in service.
I believe it was $175,000 for the ambulance, I believe.
$204,000, $206,000.
Okay.
But that ambulance has now been placed in service, so.
Yes.
Again, that's coming out of
funds. And that's still a healthy balance for that fund. I only pointed it out because it had dropped considerably from the previous report.
Right.
So I just
but it is
out.
Healthy, and that's a good reason, and that's a good place for that money to go. And I think the town has been very prudent on starting some of these funds to do that, like the sewer fund and stuff like that. So
yes.
You're doing an excellent job.
Thank you.
All right. Nothing else. Thank you very much.
Thanks. Have a good night.
Next one is Ed Tinker, the town assessor.
With his new haircut.
Hey, listen, I gotta look good for you guys, you know. I'm here this evening with Vision Appraisal, Mike Torello, Steve Whalen. They're here tonight to present the preliminary values for the 2016 revaluation. Spent a lot of time working on those. They'll go over all the analysis, the ratios. The purpose tonight, too, is to hopefully at the end of this presentation get the board's approval to send out preliminary notice value notices. I have reserved the selectmen's meeting room between July 11th and July 22nd for informal hearings. At that time, or after that time, of course, then the values will be formulated again and presented to the board as final values at that time. So I'm gonna hand it off to Mike and he can begin the presentation.
Thank you, Ed.
Thank you.
We're just handing out two documents. One's a summary.
Yep.
The second one is basically rate tables and so forth, supportive of the work that we've done.
Mr. Chairman, can I just make one request before we start?
Yes.
Try to make it as much English as possible, because sometimes when you're talking assessor talk, people don't. That plays over. That's way over. So if we can just.
Isn't that what you want, though?
Yeah.
I certainly will do that.
All right. Thank you.
This is a summary, and I'll keep it to that point. So we were contracted, and we've done the projects before, Vision Government Solutions. Again, I'm Michael Torello. I'm district manager in this area, and Steve Whalen's our project manager for the commercials. So we've gone through and done a review and an analysis of all the properties in the community. And this includes updating construction costs, updating the land values as a land as a whole as an increase, and then in individual neighborhoods, and then also adjusting the income and rates and so forth for the commercial properties. We've also done a review, a drive-by review of every property in the community to look for the accuracy of the data and to make sure that things are adjusted for the style of the home, the quality of construction of the home, the details of the structure, any topography or land issues. So our crews have gone out and looked at all of this information to make sure that they're accurate and equitable. These conclusions from these rate adjustments were tested based on sales that have occurred in the community, We were contracted to do a two-year period between 4/1/2014 to 4/1/2016. We've extended that to pretty much to date. I think we have sales included in here up to 6/15/2016. The reason why we do this is, although our study is in the past, the Department of Revenue study will be in the future and the past. They'll look at sales from 10/1/2015 to 10/1/2016. So if the trends in sales rise, it may be a different study. They do what's called the equalization study, basically their estimate of what percentage the sales are to the assessments, what comparison it is. So I'll make it very simple. If a house sold for $100,000 and the assessment was $98,000, your ratio would be 98%. So this ratio that they do is something that comes looking basically 6 months after the valuation date and 6 months before. Now, we don't have that advantage because the sales haven't occurred yet. But I think it's kind of a test for them to see where the trends are. So we tried to look at sales as advanced as possible before this date so we could see not just historically, but to be as accurate and close to sales even after the 4/1/2016 valuation date so that we're right on top of the market. So with that analysis, we concluded with our adjustments and so forth that the value increase as a whole will be approximately 17% for the whole community. Some of this is growth in the form of building permits, new construction, additions, and some of it is the cyclical pickups that the assessor does out in the field with his staff, more physical data. Approximately 12 to 13% of it will be market, and 4 to 5% of it is physical increases in value due to these permits. So we broke it up into, the sales analysis is broken up into 3 day periods. So we have one from 2014, 4-1 to 2004-1 to 2016. Then I showed it to you in 1 year, and then I showed it to you over the last 8 months for what we have. The results I showed you in different categories of comparison, so you could get an overview of the effects based on the classes of properties, like single families, condos, two families, three families, vacant land, and the commercial properties. I also showed it based on the residential styles of properties, because when values change, sometimes a certain type of house is more desirable than another type of house, depending on the cycle. I noticed that as time goes by, as we all get older, that I've noticed a trend that ranches are starting to become more popular again because people don't want to go up on the second floor anymore. So you'll see that in this, for this cycle, that on the first page to the right, you'll see that the increase in ranches was one of the higher percentages. So that was more of a demand. And actually, same thing with the raised ranches and the split levels, a little bit lower. And then the camps also, but of course the camps, a lot of them are by the water. So of course the location of those always seem to draw a higher value. On the left side where the classes of properties are, they're fairly consistent. The commercials, because it's a fairly strong rising market over the last few years, the commercials don't go up as fast because a lot of it's based on lease terms and contracts and so forth. There has been a pretty good increase here, but it wouldn't be to the pace that the residential would come up when you have a rising market. On the second page, I broke it out by most of the waterfront neighborhoods and then the inland part of the community, the remainder of the town. So you'll see that there's certain pocket areas that had higher demand, like Church Boulevard area was up at 30%. South Beach at 28, Kings Highway at 27, North Shore 26, Main Beach 24, Sun Valley 23. So the waterfront areas were more in the 22 to 23% range, where the rest of the community was 19. The 17 falls in because of the commercials coming in at a lower rate for the whole of the community. We gave you some statistics, and I'm going to make this very simple in the sense that we analyzed the properties by the classes. We analyzed the properties, as I showed you, by the styles, by the neighborhoods, and I also put a date in there so you could see trends of time of sales as they rise over the last couple of years. The study breaks it up. The first one is broken up by single families, condos, the smaller classes of residential, which are the trailers, two families, and three families. Obviously, the majority of the sales in the community are either a single family or a condominium. Actually, although we have 4,500 single families and about 2,800 condos, for the two-year period, there were more condo sales than there were single family sales. High demand for the condos. And as you can see, if you look, the only category I'd like to show you is to the right is a median assessment to sales ratio. What that is basically the midpoint, and that's our gauge. We want to be around 100% of market value. So you'll see it at that category, two-thirds to the right, for those 2 years in question, we're at 101%. The reason we're slightly over 100 is some of these sales are older, and the sales have increased in value over the last year, year and a half. If you go to the next page, you're going to see that for a one-year period, from 4/1/2015 to 4/1/2016, that ratio is at 100%. These are more current sales. And then if you look at 10/1/2015 to 6/15/2016, very current sales, we're also at 100%, which is what our goal is to do, to be at 100% of market value. We can't foresee what the trends will be over the next 3 or 4 months. We will continue to track these through the next process as we do the hearing process and so forth. There may be adjustments through hearings of people who come in with information that they give to us. We'll also look at any of the sales during that time period. So we'll be able to get sales in probably till mid-July, I would say. And we'll, if we need to adjust slightly because of that, we want to stay as close to the time period that the state's going to use, because they're going to supply you with what they identify as their ratio, which is the 6 months before and the 6 months after. So we're trying to continue to, things are fluid in this process. We're trying to stay on top of it so that our ratio study will be relatively close to theirs. If the market continues, you may have a study, a ratio study given by the state that's at 98 or 99%. The values continue to go up. I won't go in a lot of detail, but you, in this report, you'll be able to look at the commercials, the sales date. On the next page, the sale date is a little bit interesting because it gives you the quarterly sales, and it shows that the older sales are have a higher ratio because they were lesser prices than the new sales. But you can see that the last 4 or 5 quarters were right around that 100%. So we were trying to, we used all the sales as a guide so we had enough information, but we were concentrating more on the sales closer to the 4/1/2016 date, which is a better indicator of what the market is right around that time. And then we also have it broken out by the styles and then by the neighborhood. I leave that for you to look at the details. If you have any questions after you review it, you can talk to Ed or contact me. I can leave my business cards if you want to give me a call. So basically where we stand now is to wait for the approval of these values, the preliminary only, because we still have the hearing process. And then we will send out a notice to every person of the new value that they have and give them information where they can call our office to make an appointment, or they can go online, make an appointment for a hearing if they have any questions and so forth. We'll have the staff that worked on the project here available to go over the information with them. It's about a 15-20 minute informal hearing where we'll go through and explain the process. We'll look at their property record card to make sure there's any questions or information that they have, and then we'll assist them in any way we can. We'll review the changes with Ed. He'll make the recommendations if it's acceptable. We'll make those adjustments. We'll make one more look at the market, and then we'll finalize the values late July for a completion date in early August. And that's pretty much where we are right now. And then the other packet is more detailed, but it just shows some of the support of the rates and so forth that we've done for construction costs and for land values and neighborhood adjustments and market rents and capitalization rates that we use, just so you can see the up-to-date information that we have. It's somewhat supportive of this summary report that we've had. And basically, that's what I have for a presentation tonight for you, and I'll take any questions if you have it.
Any questions from the board?
I don't have any questions, Mr. Chairman.
Nice explanation. That was well done, so that I could understand it.
I've done it once or twice before.
Yeah, very good. Thank you. I just one question. On neighborhoods, when the neighborhood is an increase or decrease, does that depend upon the sales in that neighborhood? Or?
Yeah, it does. It's geared, obviously, a majority around for the type of neighborhood. And also, it's the sales, but it's also the housing stock and the location of things.
Right. Mm-hmm. So I was just looking at some that went up an awful lot and others that didn't go up that much that have very good houses. That Place Cove went up 17.
Yeah.
Whereas, 18 for the Church Boulevard.
Church Boulevard was higher than that, I think.
Church Boulevard had saw a larger increase.
30, I'm sorry.
30, yeah.
There were a lot of new condos in there, too, so would that...
Yeah, but also, this increase has a lot to do with our values from 2011 as well, not just the market. I think that area is, although it's not a high-end, talking huge dollar value, there was a substantial increase in sale prices in that Church Street neighborhood.
Yeah. Ed and I personally reviewed all the water for ourselves in the sense of the sales and then the peer review. My staff did the inner area with the neighborhoods and so forth, but all the waterfront was specifically looked at by myself, Steve, or Ed. And we took a lot of time to look at these variances and look at the differences. And Ed's been seeing this for a few years, too, as a pattern. So he kind of knew what areas are going to be a little hotter and what would be more average. So this wasn't a surprise to him when he saw those changes.
I think one thing that was really important with this reval was that we didn't reinvent what we had built in 11, but we improved it. Site indexes or the way the beach was broken out was left that way. We just had to adjust the factors for the site index, neighborhood code factors relative to the market, which made it a lot more equitable between individual properties this time. We were able to tighten up based on the information we've been gathering through the cyclical work and through the sales, just to make it a more equitable distribution between neighborhoods and areas of the whole town, not just the beach.
Great, thank you.
Yeah, and our review of the data indicated not a lot of changes. The data is in very good shape. The description of the styles and the picking up of the elements of the construction and so forth. There were minimal items that we picked up during the review.
Mr. Mead.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Mr. Chenko, what ballpark is the assessed value of Town of Hampton? Commercial and residential?
Well, currently?
Yeah.
Taxable?
Yeah.
$2.8 billion.
$2.8 billion, yeah. And how many people in your office?
One full-time and one part-time.
Okay. And how many on the staff that are doing this that were hired out? You folks?
We have about five people.
Five? Yeah. An incredible Herculean and completely professional department you run, Mr. Tinker.
Thank you.
To do billions of dollars of real estate, to contract out with these fine gentlemen to do that. It's a double-edged sword. People are doing the numbers in their head as they sit and watch TV, and they're seeing what is essentially a vote of confidence for the town of Hampton and the Seacoast in larger sense. What an extraordinary, safe place to live, to retire, to raise children. And it's going to reflect in your figures and the revenue that will be separated from taxpayers based on the equity and the professionalism and the fairness of what you folks do that separates us from other people. Having said that, we have endured the challenges of Concord, and if I may, Mr. Chairman, just for a second to contrast, we're most recently under Senate Bill 1198 that passed the House, Delaware corporation with an office in North Carolina received hundreds and hundreds of thousands of dollars in tax breaks for telephone poles. And that, of course, contrasts with what the average taxpayer in this town, working class people that live in this town, have to suck up and make up for. We had the pollution control exemption that we fought at and the board has fought in Concord, passed with the support of the Dred Commissioner, passed by the Senate and the House, that cost us hundreds and hundreds of thousands of dollars. And what I look is crony capitalism to a $15 billion company that is located in Florida. And we didn't meet with much success. Finally, we did 79E right here in our own backyard, and we gave away $175,000 on a project down the beach for what was then a very hot market and $400 per square foot sales price. And this was 3 or 4 years ago, 5 years ago when I first came on the board. So the contrast between what working class people pay for and what legislators that really don't grasp the inequity and unfairness of this concept is, these are stark numbers, and it makes taxpayers and working class people angry, and it's not fair. And we still have work to do in Concord, and we have to educate our citizenry to our efforts and elect legislators and change the game in Concord, because we're out over seven figures in this town, and people are going to be asked from single digits up to close to 30% increases in their tax rates. And that's un-American, it's unfair, and it's not right. And I want to leave it at that. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Okay. Rick?
Yeah, I would like to just point out that that area around Church Street is one of the older areas, one of the pockets where it's been being redone over the last 20 years. But that's an area that at one time it was all non-winterized homes. And they've all been winterized, and slowly the neighborhood has gone up, and people like it. You know, it's got a nice feel to it. And it's probably going to be one of the areas where you're going to get the most complaints, because these people feel disparaged by having those condominiums all sit in front of them, and they say that it's taken away their air, it's taken away their light. And I hear about this constantly from people that live in that area. But in reality, they have to understand that people are paying more for their properties, and that's what's driving this. It's all about what these properties are selling for. Maybe the ones that are on the ocean aren't getting as much, you know, they're such high price to begin with, or they're not going up that much higher percentage-wise as these other houses and homes that have been been reestablishing themselves and make a much nicer neighborhood than it was at one time. But thank you. When do you expect to have these new values out to the public?
Well, that's we're going to ask the board if you do approve sending those out. Those could be sent out by Friday, by the 1st of July.
And do we need a motion for that?
Yeah, I believe so. Yeah, you would need a motion.
I'd like to make a motion that. Yeah.
I mean, I do want to just say one thing. Utility values are not part of what we've done today. This is residential, commercial, industrial. Utility values are being worked on currently by Steve Traub, who will also, you know, within the next, hopefully, few weeks, be able to present those values to the board as well. So, okay.
So what do we need for a motion?
What do you need to do next with the report?
We need to, the vision would send out preliminary notices that would indicate the dates, the July 11th to the 22nd dates, and the information to call or to go online to schedule hearing appointments to come in.
Yeah, I'd like to make that motion, and I would like to say that The last time we did this, it really helped a lot, right, Ed?
Yeah, it did.
Because a lot of people did come in, and they were very, it was very active, and this is a busy time for everybody, and this is a good time to get those out as soon as possible.
Okay, so I have a motion. Is there a second? All those in favor? Unanimous. Okay, so we have,
thank you.
Next is the abatements.
Next, the abatements.
To do. Yep, I have two 2015 abatements. One is recommended for denial, and one is recommended for approval. 55 High Street, the approval amount recommended would be $5,619.63. 38A Dumas Ave would be recommended for denial. I'll answer any questions if you have any questions regarding those two abatements.
Any questions from the board?
No.
Seeing none, I need a motion to...
Make that motion.
To the two abatements.
One, you need them individually yet, or one for both?
The acceptance...
Well, I think you got to do them separate because one's a denial.
One for the acceptance of the abatement for 5 High Street.
Make that a...
Second. All those in favor? Unanimous. And one for a denial of an abatement for 38A Dumas Ave.
Make that motion.
Motion. Second it.
Second it.
All those in favor? Unanimous.
Okay. One last item, I believe, is the PA 28 form. Mm-hmm. Is that correct?
Correct.
Yeah. This has been, since I've been here, I've presented the form and asked that the board... I'm not utilize this form. I think the things we have in place are much do much greater job than the PA 28 form would do. Between our visits to the properties, the building department, the permits, that's basically, we're getting more information than we would off these. There is also, of course, a cost to mail out to approximately 8,500 properties. So I would ask the board continue with the not... signing it is not going to participate in the PA 28 program.
So I need a motion to sign this, that we will not be participating in the PA 28.
I'll make that motion.
I'll second it.
All those in favor? Unanimous.
Thank you very much.
Appreciate it. Thanks, Ed. Thanks, guys.
So you want me to check this will not, right?
Will not.
Oops. You should have known.
Yeah, he
almost
thank
you.
I'll just give you this.
They're going to be here.
You may be getting some anyway.
All right, thank you very much.
Thank you. You can call me directly.
Thank you.
Have fun.
Where are you?
The good times are going to start.
Right.
So the next time person we have is Peter Carey, 10 H and Highway, with Attorney Kazaza. His wife, Rita.
My name is Peter Carey, and my wife and I, Rita, have purchased the property at 10 Ancient Highway, which is on the corner of James Street and 10 Ancient Highway. It's on the water. And the property was originally built in about 1970 and is in fairly dire need of a lot of work. I applied a year ago for a permit to get a variance from the 7-foot to the 10-foot boundary restrictions. It was 7 feet, and the town has increased it to 10 feet. That variance was passed. However, part of the property is within the 7 feet of the boundary line, and in fact, it comes up to and crosses over the boundary line. So there is between 11 inches and 13 inches of foundation, which crosses over onto town property. There's also some overhang that goes into the airspace of the roof, which is another approximately 18 inches at both ends. So we're looking at approximately 2.5, 2'9" of total encroachment, which about 1 foot is on the footprint on the ground. What I would like to do is obtain a lease from the town if that is the most efficacious way to do this, so that I can go ahead and rebuild the front of the building, which is on the town property. My plan is to make it slightly smaller than it is now. Currently, that entire front of the building is a porch on the ground floor and then a solid facade across the second floor. I want to keep the porch as is, and the facade, I want to remove approximately one third of that and step that back and have a deck in that corner rather than the full front across there. The other change I'm interested in, which very minimally touches the area on town property, is I want to decrease the pitch of the roof in part of that area. So overall, I'm interested in having a smaller space occupied than is currently there, but I do need permission from the town to go ahead and proceed with this portion, which is on the town property. And I've asked Mr. Casasa to discuss any technical details about this, and I'm sure we'll be happy to answer any questions afterwards.
Mr. Chairman, we're here at the direction of your building inspector. The Careys have made two regulatory filings, if I can call it that, both of which were approved. One was in March of 2015 before the zoning board, and they received approval for a variance. At that time, that project did not include altering the first 7 feet of the structure on the ocean side because that area was subject to the deed restriction. They, as they explored their project, they wanted to see if the voters would allow them to work in that area. So they put a petition warrant article on the ballot in March of 2016 asking for the deed restriction to be waived on that side of the property, and the voters did approve that. In working with Mr. Schultz, because now they're going to be rebuilding on the foundation, new construction, he said come to the Board of Selectmen because your foundation is, as Pete described, slightly over onto town property. And I can show you a plan that was drawn in 1975 in which the town utilized when it conveyed these lots out in 1984 to leaseholders. And you can see that, as Pete mentioned, when this house was built in approximately 1971, it was constructed right on the town boundary, or as subsequent surveyors have detected, slightly over. A portion of the foundation is slightly over. And then the overhang is about 2 feet, 3 inches on that side over town property. So it's existed that way for, what would we say, close to 45 years without incident. And it certainly likely, I'm going to make an assumption, wasn't done by design to place it that way, but that's where it is. So the issue that we're faced with today and what brings us here is if we rebuild, we're rebuilding technically a foot or so at times on same foundation, but on town property with an overhang of about 2 feet. And for clarity's sake, when Pete mentions it's going to be smaller, the rebuild is going to be bigger. The overall structure will be bigger. This front area won't be as big as it is now because it's going to have, or proposed to have, a different look to it. But we're building on the proposal is to build on the same foundation that's been there for 45, 46 years, and it's located on town land. So the question is, what should be done? How should that be addressed? Is it through a lease? I know this board, or you know, some the board as the governing body of the town has addressed this issue or explored this issue, because this type of encroachment is not unique to this property, and you've had the issue before you on other oceanfront properties, north of Place Cove, what should be done, if anything, to address this. So as I say, here at the direction of the building inspector, looking for some direction. Pete has indicated, and his wife indicated, willingness to sign a lease, if that's what's deemed to be the appropriate thing to cover that 1 to 3 feet that's over on downland. So I'm happy to answer any questions. We've had Ernie Cody has been down there. Ambit, John Shagnon has been down there, looked at it, come up with the same results that the foundation slices in a portion onto town property by that 9 inches to 1 and some odd feet with a 2+ foot overhang.
No, just that the you know the question before the board, you've dealt with it, as Mr. Sizer has mentioned a number of times, to include some of the stair issues up in that same area. The question for the board is, if you want to proceed, I would recommend you direct the manager and the attorney to draw up terms at your direction, and we can make it happen. If that's what the board's inclined to do.
Mr. Chairman, good evening, Peter. Good evening, Rita. Good evening, Attorney Casasa. Of course, I'm in favor of the suggested lease, and of course it would accrue to the property. We dealt with an encumbrance on a property earlier this evening and resolved it, and I would be in favor of a very long-term lease, perhaps one that Peter and Rita's ancestors may never know who they were, but I would be in favor of something in the terms of a very, very lengthy lease to accommodate their confidence and their improvement to that property.
Second.
Any questions?
I agree.
So we have a motion by Mr. Bean, seconded by Mr. Griffin.
So the motion is to direct town council, town manager, to execute a lease consistent with the terms that we've done before. Fair enough.
In working with Mr. Casasa for the property.
Yep. Perfect.
Yeah. All's in favor? Unanimous.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Thank you very much.
Our next one is Toby Reynolds and Trish Morrissey.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Right away for the entry request along Drake's and Taylor River and the US 1.
Thank you.
Hampshire 101 interchange resurfacing. Thank you.
Thanks, Toby. Trish, and who's the third?
My name is Melly Duby. I'm also with the DOT and the Bureau of Environment.
Welcome.
We have some extra copies too, if anybody. So the reason we came was because we have a project on US 1 that extends from Seabrook to Hampton. As part of the work that we're proposing to do extends outside the right-of-way. And that work that extends outside the right-of-way lands on town property. And in Trisha's coordination with the town, she was asked to come before the board and explain the project and the impacts associated with this work. So what I'd like to do is explain a little bit more about the project and then specifically that work that extends outside the right-of-way. And then thirdly, I'd like to discuss some of the traffic control that we're planning at the US 101 interchange and how it might impact the town. Is that okay? Okay, great. So the project starts about 200 feet north of Gove Road in Seabrook on US 1 and extends through North Hampton and into Hampton up to the urban compact line, which is just north of the 101 US 1 interchange. It's basically a pavement rehab project, pavement resurfacing project. The Seabrook Hampton Falls portion of US 1 will be going in and taking out about 1.5 inches of pavement in just a few locations, then overlaying the entire road 3/4 inch with new asphalt. In the Hampton section, or approximately the Taylor River Bridge to the north through the 101 interchange, we'll be taking off 1.5 inches of pavement and paving in 1.5 inches of pavement. So there'd be no net raise in grade for that section of the roadway. All the ramps at the 101 interchange will also be repaved. Again, it'll be an inch and a half grind with an inch and a half of new pavement, with the exception of the 101 east off-ramp to US 1 south. That ramp, we need to remove all the pavement and put back 4.5 inches of pavement. That pavement is too far gone, deteriorated to leave in place. A couple other things that we're doing with the project is we're replacing all the cable guardrail that's out there with new beam guardrail. We're doing some minor drainage repairs, head walls, fixing up some that have fallen in. And we're doing bridge work at the Hampton Falls River Bridge and at the Taylor River Bridge. And that's mostly just partial deck repair. So they go in, they take the pavement off, they find the bad parts of the concrete in the deck, they take that out, patch it over, repave it. So to get to the, I'll go through the schedule real quick. We're planning to advertise this for construction in August. So we anticipate the construction to start in the spring. We'll take the full, pretty much the full construction season of 17 to complete the entire project, with a completion date of October of 2017. And it's 100% federally funded. So to talk about the Drake's River slope repair sum, I'll refer to this packet that I handed out. And on the second through, I think there's three or four pictures there to give you an idea of what's happening there at the river. The location is about 1,600 feet to the south of the 101 interchange. You're probably all familiar with where this is based on the pictures, I'm sure. Probably much, much better than I. This has been an ongoing maintenance problem for our highway maintenance folks. They've been in here a number of times over the past years to try to stabilize that the best they can right behind the guardrail. But as you can see from the pictures, it's getting worse. The erosion extends up to behind the guardrail, and eventually we would anticipate that the guardrail post will start to lean, and then if a particular event comes through, it could impact the road, which that would be a more of an emergency repair and a much more costly repair at that point. So we'd like to address this area as part of our project. On the last page, or the second to last page of the packet, where it says proposed repair to Drake's River stream bank, I apologize for the clarity, it's a little bit fuzzy. But on the left side is the plan view of the area. On the right side is the cross section, or the typical treatment that we'd be looking to do at that location. The height of the slope is about 25 feet in the highest spot, and the length of this repair is approximately 50 feet long. We would key in some pretty large stones down at the base of the slope, right at the low tide mark in the river, and then extend that stone up the slope to about 1 foot above the high tide level. The remainder of the slope would be embankment, regular roadway embankment with humus and seeded over the top of that to stabilize it. With the toe, the very bottom of the slope where we need to key into the river to hold that stone in place, it gives it that stability so it doesn't slide down into the river. That's the part that extends beyond our right-of-way. We're estimating that to be about 25-foot long section. It's under 1,000 square feet of impact when we include the temporary impact. That's for the erosion control measures that we need for the river. And so what we're hoping is that we can get a right of entry from the town for that work to stabilize this section of slope. Before I get into the traffic control, I'd like to ask if you have any questions on that work.
Any questions from the board?
I mean, it sounds like you're being proactive on it. It's definitely something that needs to get done, so.
We did bring a right of entry with us, if the board would like to sign it, or we can mail it either way, but we can leave that with you as well.
When would that work be taking place?
It would be sometime during next summer. We tend not to be really specific in the contract, unless we have to be, as far as, you know, you need to do this during this period of time or that period of time. From an environmental standpoint, is there a particular time?
Not for this work, no.
Mr. Chairman, would I just recommend that it goes to the town manager, gets the executive chop, and then we administrate that document and get it back in state.
There you go.
Okay, the second item that I'd like to discuss is the traffic control at the 101 US 1 interchange. So like I mentioned, to do the ramp work, we need to, well, for all the ramp, all the three out of the four ramps, we need to grind out the existing pavement and then pave in new pavement. We'll also be doing guardrail work. For the fourth ramp, we'll be removing all the pavement. Because the ramps are narrower than US 1, we cannot maintain the traffic on those ramps while we're doing the work. So we need to detour the traffic. Our proposal is to do the work at night. And once we start doing ramp work, it'll be 14 days of ramp work in a row. Different ramps each night, or it might be the same ramp two or three nights in a row, then a different ramp, and then they'll come back and pave them sequentially on different nights. But that work will be about 14 days of ramp work. The most logical detour for this ramp work is the last page of the handout that that I show, and it's in the red. The red detour that's shown there is to use Route 27 at exit 13 on 101. That brings that detour traffic right into the center of Hampton, and that's why I wanted to get feedback from the board tonight. Our proposal is to do this work at night, the ramp work at night. So we would allow the contractor about 10 p.m. to close the ramp down. And then by 6 o'clock in the morning, the ramp has to be open back up to traffic. So it'll be open all day, then closed at night. The ramp traffic volumes from about 10 o'clock to midnight are about 100 vehicles per hour. After that, it drops to 40 vehicles per hour. And then at 1 o'clock or so, it drops even more to about 15 vehicles an hour. It starts to pick back up again after 4 o'clock in the morning. So there's not a lot of vehicles that would be rerouted.
Can I just ask, when were those counts done? You one of the documents you said, I think you're talking about doing this particular detour during the summer. Correct. I think we'd need to dial down a little tighter what that is, because obviously those counts vary based on when in the summer that is. 4th of July is somewhat different than it is in June, right? So
yes.
I think we'd need to dial that down a little bit more as to what date you're talking about, and I know you need some flexibility.
Yes. I can check on that. I know our traffic folks gave us more of a summer number,
right,
for those ramp values. So if we can, they can definitely hone in on what particular month we want to stay away from,
right,
and we can get you that information.
Good. And those ramp values are taken of what comes off of your, the one you're repairing, correct?
Correct.
Okay.
Yes. So if we close two ramps, which we're not going to allow them, it would double.
Yep.
So we're just going to allow one at a time.
Okay.
The other thing I'd like to point out is that with GPS and people know their way around, probably the shorter detour route for this interchange area would be to use Winnicott Road as opposed to Route 27. Our plan would be to sign Route 27 for the detour. All the advanced signing, the message boards would point traffic to exit 13 to use that interchange. We feel it has more capacity. It's probably a better route for most of the traffic. And that's all I had on the detours. If you have any more questions, I'd be happy to.
Any questions from the board?
I did just agree with what Jamie said, the town manager, that make sure that you do it certain times.
Yeah, I would ask,
know what the important times are to stay away from.
I would ask that again, it prior to getting to that, we make sure we have communication with our police department and that we coordinate those times so that there's appropriate signage, they're aware of when and where, and whatever comments the chief may have in addition.
We do include in our contracts and traffic control plan all the contact people. We have a pre-construction meeting that's required by a contractor where the town and the police and the fire, they all get invited to that pre-construction meeting. And the reason for that is to go over things like this. When are you going to do this work? How are you going to do it? Where are the signs going to be? And that way they can work out the details. But we'll make sure that those contacts are in there as well.
Any other questions from the board? The only question I have is while it's really not to the detouring part of it, is when they start to restripe, are they going to take any of the considerations that we sent back when we talked about the 10-year plan?
I am aware of a couple of restriping initiatives. Maybe I'm not sure of all of them that you're referring to, but I know one of them just south of the interchange where northbound traffic, it opens up into two lanes just prior to the interchange. We're considering extending the dual-use lane or the two-way left turn lane in that area. And keeping northbound traffic in one lane until you get past that final business on the right. That's one area of striping that we're looking at. We're also looking at the northbound, US 1 northbound on-ramp to 101 westbound. There's a very quick merge there at the top of the ramp. The bridge is kind of limiting us to what we can do there from a striping standpoint. But we are looking at possibly doing some clearing in that area so that people coming up the ramp can see further down 101 and better plan for the gap that they're going to squeeze themselves into there for 101 westbound traffic.
Until they address the bridge there, which is all right. Part of the 10-year plan, has it ever been looked at of putting a stop sign there? Only because it's that very quick one and people merge there and we've seen so many accidents there. And I'm not a traffic engineer, but I don't know if that's something you guys have looked at or not.
I have seen some discussion on the stop sign. I know our traffic folks have chimed in on that some. I don't really want to speak for them, but I know some of their issues are with the geometry of that ramp. When you get to the top, if you have to stop, and you're stopped and now you're looking back, that's one of the things that they're concerned with, as opposed to, you know, a more free-flowing movement, which works well when there's plenty of gaps, but I'm sure you know that 101 traffic can be challenging to find gaps at times. Yes.
Yeah, and this is going to go on, what, in 2017?
Correct.
Okay, a lot of information tonight, Mr. Chairman. Please, thank you. And appreciate you guys coming down and interfacing. And again, we're Board of Selectmen. We have our command element. We have fire, public works, and we have police. And, of course, that's where this chop has to go. And then, of course, it comes back to the board. You're talking about detours. You're talking about traffic patterns. You're talking about our citizens and an impact. And so to fully assess that and, again, appreciate that in this incipient planning stage. But then to get that, our professionals take the job, they work with you, they present the plan, and then we wave the magic wand. That's my scheme of maneuver on that. Thank you very much.
Can I just it's changing the subject just slightly of what you should talk about, but a public comment. You heard the comment about the crosswalk, and if you have any input or influence in that, if you could check into that, just take a look at that ADA.
Yes, I actually wrote it on the back of my notes here, the South Beach State Park ADA access.
Okay.
Yes.
Just so that, you know, he's been heard and
I'm sure it's our DRED group, but we can follow up on that.
Okay, thank you very much.
Right,
yeah, I think that area crosses actually from DRED over DOT property back to Port property.
Yeah.
So it's three, but if you can look into that and respond back to me, I'd appreciate that so we can respond to the citizens' concerns. Thank you.
Okay, so if you guys will get the paperwork to them, and we will let the department head look at it and get back to you.
Okay, and Trish has the right of entry. Trish. Thank you.
Thank you very much.
Nice, guys.
Thanks for coming in so early and letting us know earlier.
Chris, do you have a card on you? Do you have a card?
It's at least nice to know about what's going on for the next year so we can, as you say, plan on it.
Great.
Perfect.
Thank you.
The next one here is, Brian McCain. from the cable committee.
That was intentional. That was good.
Well, I'm here tonight to get seek approval to have our wireless intercom, I was calling it headsets, but they're actually intercoms, repaired. We discussed as a committee to have to see if we can to either get new ones or have these repaired. And after talking to Brad Jett, who's pretty familiar with these, and the guys at Access AV, they suggest that we have these fixed, because to replace them would be about $10,000, and everything they have now is okay, but doesn't have the range or the quality of this system. So, for $1,250 in repairs and $300 for headsets, we can get it fixed. And I just think, as a committee, we think, you know, they're better than what they had, what the system they have now. So, the Access AV, their top of the line system, it's about $5,000, but. I think we play getting these fixed.
They need an authorization for that amount to fix it.
Yeah.
From the board.
That's all. Its total is $1,550.
Motion by Rick Griffin, seconded by Jim Wydell. All those in favor?
Simple.
Thank you, Mr. McCann.
Anything else? Can we help you with anything else?
No. We're trying to get it. We're getting a price together to. I don't know. Did you guys get the, Jim, did you get that?
Yes.
Letter? You did get it. Okay, so I did well with my attachment skills. we just got a quote from Access AV on that, and we'll have to get some other bids, and I'll be coming before you to see about upgrading to high definition.
Why do we use Access AV?
Because they are basically our vendor for Latronics, Total Info, and they're the one around here. Everybody else is in Boston and down Providence, and they don't like to come up this far. And they're competitive. As far as their prices on their equipment, they match or beat B&H, which is out of New York, a huge warehouse, and they always match their prices. The only difference would be their labor rate, which, you know, I think it's competitive. I think it's around $100 an hour per man, so.
But you said you can't get the labor out.
No, we tried years ago to get bids, and they just weren't interested. So we pretty much go with them. But I'm going to try again, because this might be up there in some money. So we'll see if anybody else is interested in coming down, if they can, you know, beat the price. So
very good.
Okay.
Thank you, Brian. Next one is approval of minutes.
I make a motion we approve the minutes.
If I could just point out one issue that was brought to my attention earlier tonight on page 5, it was dealing with in the last meeting, you were discussing the issue with the conservation. Tonight we had two separate ones. So there was the conservation exchange for the Cornerstone project, and on page 5, and that's under A, B, and C in the center of it, under what would be section 5, A and B is related to the Cornerstone project. C should be separated out on its own. It was a separate discussion with regard to that forested land map that we talked to Barbara about afterwards. So I would recommend we make that change. They appear in the same section. That needs to be separated out as its own discussion.
Any other recommendations for the minutes? Seeing then, a motion to accept as amended. Be in order. Mr. Bean, seconded by Mr. Wydell. All those in favor? Unanimous. Old business.
You already took care of the number one, so if there's any other old business.
I have old business.
Okay.
Well, I talked to Mr. Sullivan about this, that we had some complaint by one of the condominiums down on Ocean Boulevard about some of the issues they mentioned were the parking lot that's being run at the Riviera Motel. And I noticed that Mr. Marr, the manager, is out there. So I don't know if...
I'd be happy to tell you what, since they came in informally, there are a number of... one that was brought to my attention a number of times, but earlier also. So there's a number of lots that folks have come in and complained that are not in compliance with, or alleged to be not in compliance with, our ordinances or the planning board's requirements in order to run a temporary parking lot.
So we've had conversations with planning today, and we understand what the process is to go out. Our issue is it's often on the weekends. It's often these complaints have to come in to building, who is the enforcement arm generally. We're looking at whether or not we can utilize some other folks. We have parking enforcement folks for the town, whether or not we can utilize those folks in the enforcement action. We have to identify that they're actually performing the function, find out whether or not there is an approval, and if not, there is an enforcement process that is somewhat lengthy to go out and have compliance. But the first part is identifying them. Second is finding out whether they do. I'm told by planning this is an annual thing that has to happen to get the temporary approvals. And currently, in our first, you know, blush, it appears that there are none approved for this year for the temporary aspect. The more permanent ones obviously are. So we're endeavoring to follow up on that. It is certainly a large, widespread issue, and we're going to be working it.
Yeah. And I noticed that one of the things that the people had complained about was there was some furniture that was out on the sidewalk or on the property, actually, but it was out there. I noticed they've removed it, which should make the people in the condominium somewhat happier. So we appreciate that.
Just on that fact, is there a difference between somebody renting out their lawn for parking versus a business that has a motel renting out the spaces that are not being used?
Yeah, planning has a document that they have done, the guidance, in order to get a temporary lawn. And there are requirements. And so, no, my front lawn would not fit the requirements that they have to get that. That's a separate issue. But there are appropriate processes. For example, if hypothetically there's a business or a hotel that has a parking lot that is not being utilized because, say, a hotel is not functioning this year, certainly would appear to fit their process. It's a parking lot. It has identified spaces. As long as it meets the space requirements that it has, certainly seems like one that could be approved by the board to do so. The others are separate issues, using your front lawn or your driveway. It's not uncommon. We have very small ones where folks will park their cars on the street and rent out their driveway to folks to make a buck. So those would not likely fit the process for the planning board to get a temporary parking lot.
Having driven down the beach this weekend, I noticed there were a number of them in the Whites Island area that people had parked their cars out on the street and then were renting the spaces in their yard.
And that happens frequently, in my experience. So I would ask that any of these businesses that are in this sort of circumstance come into compliance. That's the first. Please, comply with the law. Go down and get your approval. We'll do everything we can to get you done with the process quickly. But we are receiving complaints, and we will be going out with our enforcement folks to take the appropriate action.
Very good. Anything else on all business? I have one thing. I noticed the speed table is put in on Moore Ave.
Yep.
It looks real good. I saw a couple of cars going slow over that. I've noticed we replaced the signs on Dearborn Ave about speed limit. One that we haven't addressed is Toll Ave, because that's the other part of that cut through. When they come up off Winnicunnet Road, they cut up Toll Ave to cut across. And there are no speed limit signs on that road. There are a number of no parking signs.
Yeah, related to the school.
I'm assuming there are no parking signs because you can't read them anymore.
Internet, yes, yeah, okay.
So there's that there. There's also a sign on the pole at the Stickney Terrace. Has to talk about a crosswalk. Or once talked about the crosswalk, but I don't believe you can read it anymore. So if the Public Works Director could look at that, that would be. Anything else? New business. We have the issuance of the dog warrant.
Yes, we do. Mr. Chairman, here is the document of the dog warrant. The clerk's office has processed all that they have. The law now requires that the board send this to the chief of police for further enforcement or hopeful compliance.
So moved.
Any discussion? So moved. Second? All those in favor?
VIPs on that list.
I've noticed some of the ones on there, and as a matter of fact, I informed one of them earlier.
You're not on there, are you?
No. But same last name. Closing comments. Mr. Bean?
None, sir.
No. Mr. Griffin?
Thank you. Okay,
Mr. Chairman.
I'd just like to make one closing comment about public comment tonight. You know, I mean, public comment's there
for serious matters. And the preambulation should be done. It is an RSA, but let's not make mountains out of molehills, please. And let's not go on and on and on about things. People have got to learn to respect what's going on and think about the bigger issues. And I agree with what Mr. Bean said earlier. That it was informed. Everybody knew about it. Bingo. Let it go.
And to that fact, we've had a couple people come in and talk about legal matters and something being illegal. Well, if it's illegal, that's their opinion. That is not fact. It is nothing but their opinion. And if there is something illegal, then bring it forward. If it's not, don't be causing accusations that are untrue.
Absolutely. Mr. Chairman, I would just like to thank the other people that came in and Mr. Maher out there, because it's hard for as many people that came down here earlier, and I think they were being respectful not to waste our time for each one to get up and say the same thing. But I think it's very important, and things like this make it much easier that everyone gets along in the neighborhoods. And I know that the Atlantic Breeze works hard to try to do the right thing, and you know, it's hard to please everybody.
Sounds like the parking issue on Boys Head is being looked at.
Yeah, there was some new information in the packet today that certainly will aid in doing some exploration there, so we'll get working on that tomorrow. Thanks.
Very good.
Motion to adjourn at 2057, Mr. Chairman.
Second. Jim, all those in favor? Unanimous. Thank you.
Good to see you, Jarhead.